Good day. So this is 现代 汉诗, which translates as modern Chinese poetry, one of the many unofficial poetry journals we've been collecting at Leiden University for about 30 years. It is from 1991. It's the first issue of this journal. They went on to publish for a couple of years into the mid-1990s. And one of the things that make it special is that this is a nationwide effort. So here, there's a long list of names, and it reads like a who is who in Chinese poetry at the time. I've got to make a big caveat there. It is also highly male-dominated, so women are close to invisible here. And I'm stressing that it was a nationwide effort because that is not necessarily what you might expect if you think about things like unofficial cultural production, people doing DIY, literature, music, digital video, you name it. But this is actually a nationwide effort, people teaming up, whereas the many local poetry scenes in China are in relentless competition, so teaming up is kind of a big deal, to agree that they would jointly publish a journal and that the journal would travel. So this first issue, the opening issue, was made, physically made in Beijing, but then later issues were made in Shanghai, in Hangzhou, I think in Chengdu as well, four big places in Chinese poetry. And from all of these details, on that first page with the names and the mission statement, there's tons of things we can learn. For example, the positioning of the poets' names tells us a lot. Perhaps unexpectedly, the name that is last on the list is actually the one that everybody knows matters the most. And why is that? Because that person is called Meng Ke, and he was one of the founding editors of the Fountainhead Journal, the journal that started it all in 1978 in the unofficial poetry circuit. So what you see here is also a kind of continuity, a kind of tradition, Meng Ke still being around, right, 15 years later, to be part of this journal again. Another thing you can tell from the names here, if you know enough about the poetry scene, is that the boundaries between the unofficial and the official poetry scene in China are very, very blurred, right? They're nowhere near absolute. It's not the case that if you are part of the unofficial scene, you can never publish in the official scene or the other way around. And how can I tell from this bit of data? Well, the three managing editors for this particular issue are, in addition to Meng Ke, whom I just mentioned, Tang Xiaodu and Lin Meng, both of whom worked for many years at a flagship journal in state literature in China called Shikan, or Poetry Journal, out of Beijing. So that sort of stuff tells you a lot, just like the mission statement will tell you all kinds of things. The disclaimers that I made here, very clearly, people saying what we do is purely a literary endeavor, right? It has nothing to do with anything else. This is also for internal exchange. We're not about to publish this officially. We're not going to market it. So these journals, this one, like I said, is a very pretty specimen. We've been collecting at Leiden University for about 30 years. And the big paradox that lies at the heart of this material is that it's been hugely influential in Chinese literary development ever since the late 1970s, after the Cultural Revolution, when the underground poetry written during the Cultural Revolution came above ground. But at the same time, while it is hugely influential, it is incredibly hard to find. And very few researchers and students and, you know, other readers and translators actually have the chance to lay hands on this material or lay eyes on it. Because this stuff doesn't travel through the regular sort of formal infrastructure of libraries and bookstores, even though that is changing in China as we speak, so big university libraries are now starting to take an interest as well, as is the National Library. But you know, I mean, they're gonna have to catch up. This is one of the reasons that we've been collecting this stuff for a long time now, and also that we've been digitizing it to address that paradox, to make sure that this material, which is so influential yet so hard to get, is going to be accessible to anybody with an internet connection. So how does the collecting happen? How has this stuff ended up in Leiden? 1991, the year that this first issue of Xiandai Hanshi was made, was also the year that I did my first fieldwork trip for my PhD research. And what I had sort of envisioned for that trip was traveling to China and then, you know, going to libraries and bookstores and finding all the material that I needed. But I found out very quickly that the kind of poetry that I was interested in was not in the libraries and hardly in the bookstores, and that you needed to find your way into the unofficial circuit, this incredibly tight network of poets and critics and academics, where it all happened, you know, where poetry was being written and published, DIY, traveling through personal networks, that kind of thing. And I think on that first trip, I probably brought back about 20 kilograms of this material in a backpack. So I've kept doing that over the years and built relationships with the poets and the editors in the unofficial circuit that enable us at this moment to also work together with them in the digitization project, which wouldn't have been possible without their support.